The upcoming presentation is a two-man power trip of wrestling podcast production.
And now for something completely different.
Hey, I'm a Hall of Famer. I'm in three Halls of Fame. For the young fans, they don't give a damn. They just give a damn about themselves and what they're hearing now. And I got no problem with those rules. I know the rules going in. I'm happy to play the game that way.
And when Ivan came off with that knee drop from the top rope and he bent me, I thought that something happened. I couldn't hear a thing. You could have heard a pin drop in that arena. It touched me so deeply that when I went in the dressing room, I really felt depressed.
I'll tell you that, I'll tell you right to his face. If Hogan and I, if he wanted to get in a real street fight with me, trust me, he would lose, and he knew it.
You know, that's the other thing. They give you the belt, and they're like, okay, you're in charge of me. I was like, what?
When you mentioned a guy like Harley Race, that kind of legendary status, it's obvious why people would get upset.
Boy, as I'm concerned, Roddy Piper was not a wrestler. He wasn't even a good worker. If he had to go out and work his way to the top and not have good friends like Jim Barnett. I mean, I'm not saying he's not a good guy. He's just not a tough guy.
Bro, I swear to you, I don't have an ego. Like, I don't give a crap. That stuff is not important to me. People don't know me. They have no idea of who I am. They know of me as being a fictional character that they saw on TV.
People didn't understand that, you know, the guy they saw in the ring that happened to be using his real name and happened to actually be the president of the company, they really believed that that guy that they loved to hate was actually a pretty decent guy. And I think many people had the perception that I really was that character.
Welcome to the two-man power trip of wrestling. I'm your host, GP John Paz. With me today is a very special guest. She is, of course, one-third of the Free Babes in the NWA. She's, of course, the daughter of Jimmy Wang Yang. She is Jazzy Yang, making her first ever podcast appearance. Jazzy, welcome. How are you doing today?
I'm great. I'm glad to be here. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad. Cannot complain. This is pretty cool. Talk to your dad. This is your first ever podcast appearance. I love it.
Yep, I'm really nervous.
Oh, you don't be nervous. It's very easy. It's probably easier than wrestling a match on NWA TV. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So what's going on in your world? What have you been up to?
So just training and trying to master my craft, and I just had the NWA thing. I'm just doing some shows in Georgia for Lariato Pros Wrestling and all of that.
How did the NWA thing come about? Like who contacted you? How did that all go down?
So Mickey posted on her Twitter looking for wrestlers, and someone said Jazzy Yang, and she said, Jimmy, hit me up, we haven't talked in a while. And then they had a phone call, and then we went down to Nashville actually to meet her, and we sat down with her, and she asked me to be on the pay-per-view. And then we later on, then she texted about the Free Babes idea, and it was actually her idea, and she was like, I have this great idea, Miranda Gordy, her dad's legacy, and all the second generation wrestlers, we can put them together, and it'd be the Free Babes, it'd be great. And then we said yeah, and that's how it happened.
It's just that easy, huh? You just contact Mickey, hey, I'm in, I'm interested.
Yep. Well, we had to show her some of the videos of my footage, and we had the meeting in Nashville at her house. And I had to show her that I really wanted it and that I was ready to do it.
What is like when you first get there initially, what's the meeting like? Is it like a little pressure? Is she cool? Like, how does that go down?
She was really nice. So this wasn't like the first time I met Mickey. She used to take care of me in the back during WWE shows. Like, my dad would go wrestle and I would go hang out with her, and she'd take me into the Divas locker room. So she was really nice to me when I was little. That's what I remember her from. So it's kind of coming full circle, meeting someone who used to take care of me when I was little. And it's kind of natural. And the conversation, when we had the conversation, it was more serious, but everything was like talking to a friend.
When that goes down, what's kind of going through your head? Like, wow, this is a huge step up. I'm going to be on, you know, national pay-per-view, I'm going to be on TV. I mean, it's a big step up as far as wrestling wise.
Yeah, I was really excited, especially coming from Mickey James. Like, she used to take care of me. It felt like everything was coming just full circle.
With Mickey and doing that, the Empower. What did you kind of think of just the idea of Empower and it being the all women's pay-per-view? What was your thoughts on that?
It was great. I'm a really big feminist. Me and my friend used to have this club. We started this club at my high school. It was called GALS, Girl Athletic Leadership Squad. So we were really about women empowerment. So hearing about this and then getting to be a part of it was a really big deal for me. And it was great.
What did you think about the show? Like how everything went and your performance, everything like that?
Yeah, I loved it. I really think we hit a home run with it. Everybody loved it. The fans were there. They were going crazy. It's a really good crowd. And then being able to watch it back was really cool.
What did you think about the pairing? I know Mickey said she's going to put you guys together, make you the Free Babes, going to be a part of this big pay-per-view. But what did you think about Miranda and what did you think about Haley J?
So first, we had no idea. We did not know each other. We were all really spread out. But my dad and Miranda's brother actually were partners in WWE. And so we just met up there and we were just like, oh, we'll see if it works. And it actually did. And we actually did really good. So.
Oh, did you know each other at all, though? Or no, only your dad knew her brother. That's
no.
It.
Only through my dad and her brother.
That's kind of interesting. I forgot about Ray Gordy. He hasn't been kind of hiding. Hasn't really been around. Yeah, that's right. They were partners.
He's a police officer.
Oh, no wonder. Okay. No wonder I haven't seen him wrestle. That's a pretty serious job there. With Miranda, how do you think the chemistry is with her? Obviously, you know, your dad and her brother's great chemistry, but how do you think you and her did?
I think we did great. It was crazy because it's like the first time we ever met, first time we ever wrestled together, and I feel like we worked really well as a team.
Second generation wrestlers. I think that's a good thing. You have it in the blood. With Haley, were you familiar with her at all? Did you know her at all?
There was one that I trained with a girl named Ari Alexander in Ohio, and she wrestled her a lot. And my dad met her once at, like, one of the shows in Ohio, but I never met her. But I met her there, and she was really nice.
When Mickey comes up with this idea and she puts you guys together, like, what did she say as far as, like, why did she think that you guys would be a great pairing or a great trio?
Basically that we are all second-generation wrestlers. And Miranda's dad, and basically that was all. And she came up with the idea herself and just kind of let us know that we're all second-generation wrestlers. Miranda's dad is this, and it'd be great for me to be with other people that have been in the business longer.
So you guys wrestled Red Velvet and Kylan King. What'd you think about those guys or those gals?
Oh, they were really good. They were really professional. I wish we would have came out with the win, though.
Is it great exposure for you, great experience? Like, what was your kind of takeaway from the show?
Both, really. It was a great experience. Really got me a lot of exposure. And being on the pay-per-view is actually one of my first big pay-per-views. So it was really cool being in the locker room with everybody. And then with that many fans there, and then doing more stuff like this podcast.
Was it a big success, the pay-per-view overall?
I think it was. I think it was a really good success.
Was that definitely the biggest match of your career, or have you had others? I know you teamed with your dad, too, but was that the biggest match you've had so far in your career?
Yeah, I think it was. For me, I've never been on like that big of a pay-per-view before. I actually debuted in Japan when I was 15 with my dad and his old partner, Kaz Hayashi versus Mizawa and Shannon Moore. And that was my first one, but I just had a spot in it. And that was really big because it was the first time I was ever going to be out in front of people doing wrestling. And then my second match, I debuted in the U.S. in my hometown. So that was like in front of all my friends and family. So that was kind of a lot of pressure too. But I think this one was more because it was on pay-per-view.
Pretty cool, the debut. I didn't realize you were that young when you wrestled in Japan. How did that all come down? Your dad basically was like, hey, let's get you in the ring, or how did that happen?
So I decided, I was like, I want to try this out. So we started training a little bit, And I actually took my first bump when I was 12 with my best friend at the time. Her name was AJ. We were like, we want to be divas. That was when the Funkadactyls were wrestling, and we wanted to be just like them. We even went to a show dressed like them. But then my dad got the call from Kaz for the opportunity to go wrestle, and he was like, well, can my daughter come? And they were like, for sure. So then they're like, oh, yeah, she can have a spot. And then I got to do that. And after that, I really wanted to wrestle because being in front of all those people, like, kind of gave me an adrenaline rush, and it felt great. It was like a high, and then that's how I got the wrestling bug. And then I started training more. But then I had school and high school and basketball and all the sports I played, so I took a little bit of a break. But then the pandemic hit, and then I started really training more.
Were you ready at 15 to get in there and do that match in Japan?
I think I was. It took some training. Like, the first time I trained, I almost broke my arm. But it was during basketball season, so I'd lie and say I fell during practice. But it was actually it was really hard training wrestling compared to basketball or all the other sports.
Man, it's completely different. Like, to get in there and take the bumps and take the, you know, to run the ropes even. Sometimes you get bruised from the ropes. Sometimes when you take the bump, you almost feel like your lungs are caving in. It's a weird feeling, right? I mean, getting out there and doing that training, completely different.
Yeah, it's a completely different sport.
With your training, who trained you? Was it your dad?
Yeah, my dad trained me, and I trained with him and his girlfriend at the time, his now ex-girlfriend. We both trained together because it was a pandemic, so we had nothing else to do, but there was a ring down the street, so we would go there, and she would just come and train with me, and then more people started to come, and I just trained with, like, a small group in Ohio.
What was it like?
But now I'm training. Sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry to cut you off. Yeah. So where are you training now?
No, it's okay. I'm training at the Nightmare Factory in Atlanta, Georgia. We actually moved here a couple months ago.
Wow, didn't realize that. Nice. So Cody, I guess, he's not the trainer. I guess he's the owner, but QT Marshall, I guess, is the trainer down there?
Yeah, he's really cool. But I went to some night class with them, but I trained more with my dad during the day there.
Oh, he's a trainer there as well?
Just with me and, like, helping out a few other people.
With the Nightmare Factory, like, how did that come to be? How'd you get down there, and why did you go down there?
So my dad used to live here. This is his hometown with all his family. And when he got, like, stationed in Cincinnati for wrestling, and he met my mom, then they had me. But he didn't really want to be in Cincinnati, but he was there for me. And once I graduated, we were like, I wanted to go somewhere new, somewhere bigger than Cincinnati, Ohio. So, and he wanted to go back home, so we were like, oh, let's move here. And we moved to Lawrenceville, and then we were looking up, like, wrestling schools around, and the Nightmare Factory is only 10 minutes away. So it was perfect to go there.
Were they happy to have you?
Yeah.
See, that's pretty cool, the Nightmare Factory with Cody, and obviously your dad can help you. So what's it like training under your dad? I mean, is that easier, harder? Like, what do you think? Is he hard on you?
Yeah, he's hard on me. It's a little bit different because you have to, like, go home with your trainer, and then you get to, like, you know, everybody knows, like, the dad lecture in the car after, like, basketball games and stuff like that, but it's the same with wrestling. So
he's not taking it easy on you.
No.
With that training and stuff, like, what does he do a lot of? Is it basically getting ready for wrestling, or is he getting you in shape? Because you always hear trainers sometimes, before you're even allowed in the ring, they make you do all this sorts of crazy cardio, and they want you in crazy shape.
Yeah, so me and him work out every day, but then we go to the wrestling school. So we work out at the gym, then go to the wrestling school. But with the when we were in Ohio, we had the trainees. We'd all have to do the squats, like the hundreds of squats and ab workouts and stuff like that, which was hard. And it was hard, really hard in the beginning, but as you get used to it, it's still hard, but it gets easier.
What is, like, the easiest part of the training for you? Like, what have you kind of taken to a lot easier?
I really enjoy chain wrestling a lot and looking up new videos and doing that part of it.
What brought you to that part of it? I'm surprised it's not like the high flying and you know, doing some aerial moves.
Yeah, I'm scared of heights, so the high flying. It's getting there, it's getting there. But I like the intensity of chain wrestling. And then Dean Allmark on Instagram, I don't know if you know who that is, but he posts these videos of like cool different kinds of chain wrestling. So we have the basics and then we get to try out that kind, and it's really cool having like something new every practice.
So he is, do you think, harder than you, like on you than other people, or you think that he's just a tough trainer in general?
I would say he's a tough trainer in general, but if they didn't say anything, they wouldn't care. So I kind of take it as that.
I'm kind of curious, like with him, like in general, is he the reason why you really wanted to get into the business, or like how did you know that you wanted to be a wrestler, and like why did you break in?
So just being around it growing up and seeing, like, I've always loved women's wrestling. I like watching the girls wrestle. And just being around that environment with Mickey James and Melina and Gail Kim, it's like I loved like seeing them go out in these cool costumes or whatever and be a character out there. I really loved that part. And then getting to go to Japan was like, I can travel and do this. Like, that was really great, really cool to me.
Did he want you to be a wrestler at first, or did he kind of want you not to be a wrestler?
I mean, there's always the scares of wrestling, he said, like all the bad parts of it, but he said it was the greatest time of his life, being able to travel and have all the friends you get with wrestling, so he doesn't want to stop me from being able to experience that and always wanted to support me in what I do.
You think that he's also seeing the other side of things, the injuries and, you know, anything that could happen in the business? It's a crazy world out there.
Yeah, he's seen it all. I haven't gotten serious injured yet, but I've played sports all my life. So the injury thing kind of comes with all the sports, but there's no risk, there's no glory.
That is true. With him, and obviously, he wrestled everywhere, obviously, WCW, WWE, I mean, he's been around the block. Is he kind of the best mentor you have, you think? Or maybe it's not good to have a father as a mentor?
I think he's the best mentor that I have. He's like one of the only mentors that I really have, but I think he's really good. He knows like the psychology of wrestling and everything that it takes to be a wrestler, so I think he's a great coach for me.
What's kind of some of the best advice that he's given you?
Details are important. Details, details, details. He always stresses about details, and everything is important in wrestling, from your hands, from when you walk out, from when you're in the ring. I think those are the best advice. And if you feel like you're going slow, go slower, and a bunch of other advice, but those are the really ones that stuck out.
When he says that, like, what does he mean by your hands and stuff? Like, as far as maybe playing to the crowds, things like that?
Just like details, especially in chain wrestling, like there's small things where you can tell if someone's legit or not. And that's really important because you want to make people believe, you want to be the most believable wrestler and you want to be legit. So grabbing holds the right way, submissions, everything like that, like everything in wrestling is important, and people who don't take it seriously kind of make it look bad. But
do you study specific? I know you said mentioned Dean Allmark and watching his stuff. Do you watch like tape of your dad, or do you watch maybe like Dean Malenko, or like, who do you watch as far as like learning and studying the craft as far as the chain wrestling?
I watch the Dean Allmark guy on Instagram. He shows like a bunch of European styles. I like to look at his, but also I would like to work in martial arts with my chain wrestling, and I started doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu at American Top Team here, and I like incorporating that into my chain wrestling, so bring like new forms of fighting into the chain wrestling.
Are you learning some submissions over there?
Yeah, of course.
How are you doing? How's the training going?
At the top team?
Yeah.
The first couple of times were, I got beat up a lot, but they made me tap out a lot, but I'm getting the hang of it. And it's actually, I enjoyed it. I enjoy it a lot. And it's really good cardio, really good for working out too. I'm drenched when I come out, so that's always good.
Yeah, the cardio when you do this, that's unbelievable. But they throw you in the deep waters right away, especially if you're grappling with somebody more experienced. You're like, damn, I never really realized it's such a chess match. Like, you have to be out thinking them.
Yeah. They just threw me in there, and they're like, okay, just try. But I kept turning into my stomach, and then they'd choke me out.
Always a bad thing to give them your back. Always bad.
Yeah.
With that, too, it's one of those things. It's like you think, like, okay, you could be tough, but you can't just be tough. You have to be smart and tough because you got to play that mental chess game. Like, okay, if they're going to, you know, try to sweep me or something, like, you always have to be thinking of the next move.
Mm-hmm. It's like a whole new sport.
If you're doing that and you're training at Nightmare Factory, do you think that you have much time for anything else? I mean, is your sole focus right now is to become a better wrestler?
My focus right now is to master the craft. That's what I really want to do. But I do have some free time. Like, so we go during the day from, like, we go to the gym at, like, 12, and then we would go for, like, an hour and a half or something, and then go to train wrestling 2 to 4. But I train wrestling on, like, Monday, Wednesday, and then go to jiu-jitsu Tuesday and Thursdays at night. But there's some free time in there.
Seems like you're really honing the craft. Like you said, mastering the craft, that's awesome. You're putting in the work, if you will, like a little Cody Rhodes-ism there. You're putting in the work.
Yeah.
So I also read and saw online you said you want to be the next John Cena. What did you mean by that?
I want his bank account.
But you mean like the celebrity part or the top wrestler part or both?
I wanted the money. Yes. But I also want to be in movies, like make it that big in wrestling that you get to be in movies like The Rock and him and be a part of like commercials and stuff like that. That's always been really cool to me too.
Do you think that the acting part too, are you going to start going to acting school and do that stuff, or are you one step at a time?
Yeah, I want to work on my acting too. Cause that's also a big part of wrestling, your character, and I want to be able to be good at everything.
Got to create that character. So with you and character, are you going to be like a Jazzy Wang Yang, or you want to be your own woman? Like, do you want to kind of separate from your dad's gimmicks and stuff like that?
I kind of want to separate because I'm not a cowgirl at all. I grew up in Liberty Township, Ohio, and that is not country. So I really don't feel like that one fits me at all. And I want to be my own person.
What kind of gimmick are you looking to create? I know obviously the Free Babes is a little bit different in the NWA, but what do you think for yourself?
Right now, I'm Shownuff. Have you ever seen Barry Gordy's The Last Dragon?
Yes, yes.
So I think Shownuff is the perfect heel, and I really wanted to be his character. So now I'm the Show Yang of wrestling, Jazzy Yang.
Nice, I like that, nice. So definitely no Jazzy Wang Yang or anything like that.
No, but my Twitter and Facebook is Jazzy Wang Yang.
Just to maybe get the name over first and get people to recognize you, and then...
Yeah. And Jazzy Yang was taken.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, on Facebook and Twitter. But it's still Jazzy Yang on Instagram. I got that one a while ago, but I'm kind of newer to Twitter and Facebook.
That's another thing with wrestling these days. It's like you got to master social media too, right? I mean, you almost need a crash course. Obviously, you're younger, so you can probably deal with it a lot better than a lot of other people. But I feel like social media is a big part of the game in wrestling now.
Yeah. Facebook, I still don't understand Facebook. I just learned how to work Twitter, but my social medias are like Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok. That's what I like. But that's my generation. But I'm trying. I just learned how to work Twitter, and I need to figure out Facebook.
They always say like Instagram stuff is for like the younger generation, and that Facebook's always like the older generation. For sure. What is that about, like, Instagram and stuff that it's, I don't know, if, I guess they just, the younger generation just likes it better. What is it about Instagram that's so great? I'm on it, but I'm not really into it that much.
I think because I got, like, an iPod Touch in fourth grade, and Instagram was more for younger people, and I was allowed to have Instagram. Like, kids were allowed to have Instagram, but we weren't allowed having Facebook. So I think it evolved from that.
I don't get Snapchat, so it's like a 2 second, you take a picture and the person can see it for 2 seconds? Like, I don't even understand what's going on with Snapchat.
Well, you don't actually have to, like, have a conversation with the person. You can just, like, take a picture of their ceiling and send it. And then you have, like, streaks that you can keep, and it'll say how many days in a row that you snapped each other.
Wow, weird stuff. So you don't actually have to really communicate with the other person.
Yeah, not really. Unless you want to, but
yeah, it's
and little like your siblings or whatever can't go through your stuff because it goes away right away.
So. Oh, okay. So if anybody wants to see it permanently, probably screenshot it or something like that.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. But as far as let's get back to your dad for a second. When, you know, you said you went to the shows and stuff, but were you a big, big wrestling fan? Like, were you, did you grow up a big fan or did you kind of watch it because he was in it?
So when I was growing up, I was scared of it. Like, I would watch him get hurt and I would be so scared because I thought he was going to die. And going backstage and seeing, like, I was really scared of CM Punk, actually, because he shaved that girl's head and I was so scared he was going to shave my head. So I'd hide behind my dad and stuff like that. So I was more scared of, like, the guy characters, but I love the girl characters.
That's great. He was
for
doing
me watching my dad, yeah. But there, being that age and watching my dad get beat up, it's like, ah.
Yeah, because you still think it's real, right? I mean, you're still buying into the characters and stuff. He's not telling you, right? He's not breaking kayfabe, right?
Yeah, I was born in 2003, so I was really young.
Yeah, man, oh, man, you were really young during that era. And when Punk was doing that straight edge society thing, shaving people's heads, you had to be maybe 7 or so. I'm trying to remember what year it was. But, yeah, that was mid-2000s or a little bit maybe towards 2010.
Yep, that would scare the crap out of me. I would have nightmares of it.
I bet you weren't happy to see Punk return then for AEW.
Yeah, he looks a lot more friendlier now.
Yeah, definitely. So, obviously, we're kind of talking about how young you are. You're so young in the business. Do you think that it's almost crazy to think, like, wow, I'm this young, and I've been on pay-per-view, I'm wrestling in Japan. I mean, you're so young in the business, but you're getting a lot of great experience. Like, how do you feel about that?
It's great. It's kind of like another full circle moment. My dad started so young, and he was wrestling when he was 18, and now I'm wrestling when I'm 18. So it's kind of like history repeating itself for me.
What do you think about teaming with him a lot? Because obviously you guys done that a few times. What about teaming and wrestling with him?
It makes it a lot easier, and he kind of like coaches me from the side. So it's kind of like good being with someone you know out there and going to all these places with someone you know. It just makes it easier.
Do you learn a lot, like, in the ring from him, watching him and being in there with him?
Yeah, of course. He knows a lot, so.
I feel like sometimes with, like, a younger wrestler, I think psychology is a hard thing to kind of figure out. And because you see a lot of, like, crazy spots and this and that, and there might get a great reaction from the crowd, but then there's maybe not a lot of selling. Is he pushing a lot of psychology and selling on you?
Yeah. So I learned the psychology while training. Like, that was also a part of it. And now it's, like, ingrained in my head how to make a match, stuff like that. I'm still learning more, but I have the basics down in the psychology.
So as you're coming through and coming along, where else have you wrestled? I know NWA and stuff, but where else have you wrestled?
So there was Japan, Cincinnati, Ohio. I wrestled in Vegas when I actually wrestled in Vegas my senior year, which was like this past year, and I actually got kicked off the basketball team for doing it. So that sucked, but it was also fun being in Vegas. I'd rather choose going to Vegas than playing basketball. But
why'd you get thrown off the team?
I don't really know. So I had COVID like 2 weeks before. So I got COVID and I was out for 2 weeks, and then I came back and they're like, you can't get COVID for 3 months. So there's no way you can be quarantined or whatever. And then I had to go to Vegas and our tournament got pushed back because other teams had COVID or something like that. So I had to miss the first game. And when I was, they said okay, but then when I was there, they was like, you're kicked off the team because we think you're high risk of COVID. Even though you're within the 90 days where you can't get COVID, we still think that you shouldn't be come back. And then the athletic director said, well, you can't miss a game or practice, but this is the only one I've ever missed. But my dad and the athletic director don't get along that well.
I could see why. Damn.
Yeah. And then my dad tweeted F our athletic director, and then he got blocked from our school.
Sounds about right. I thought maybe they were pissed that you became a wrestler. Like, hey, we want you to become, you know, fully engaged with the team. I thought maybe they'd be pissed that you were wrestling.
I think that was more the reason, because it wasn't my coach's decision. My coach was fine with it, but it was the athletic director, and he was like one of those haters on wrestling.
Wow.
But you can't say that's the reason.
Wow, unreal. And he hates your dad. Wow, it's crazy. So with you, and we were kind of mentioned before, but there's obviously a woman's revolution right now in wrestling. What do you think? I mean, it seems like, is the tide turning? Is this woman's revolution going to stick? I mean, are these women wrestlers seem like they keep getting better and better?
Mm-hmm. I feel like so. People just keep getting better and better. There's more women in it, so there's more competition. More people are working harder at it. More people are athletes. More people are loving wrestling instead of just being, like, picked out of a catalog like they used to be. But
is NWA, like, back on the horizon? Are you going to be working with them again, or was that just a one-off?
They haven't said anything to us about anything else, but I hope to.
Did you work the tapings at all that were right after the pay-per-view?
No, we left to come back home before that, but they're supposed to be coming to Atlanta in December, I think, so maybe we'll do something there, but we're not sure yet.
Nice. You got to let them know that you're in Atlanta now, you know? You got to get that, get your name out there. So what about, like, AEW? I mean, you're training at the Nightmare Factory. Obviously, you're on their radar because anybody that trains there is definitely. What are your thoughts on working for AEW?
Yeah, I would love to. I'd love to work for any company around here. It'd be great. I want to travel everywhere. I want to go to like every company I can. If that can take me around the world, I would love to do it.
Is the reason for training there is to get into AEW, or that's just kind of a happenstance? That just happens to be.
No. It was it was close and convenient for us, so that's why we started training there.
As far as, like, getting more on their radar or getting on anybody's radar, like, what do you think you could do to improve, or what do you want to improve?
For me, I just want to master the craft. I want to, like, be good at everything. I really need to be better at my talking and my acting. I really need to improve on that. But really, I need to improve on everything. And I really just want to be able to reach the final level.
So what do you do for that? Do you, like, do promos in the mirror? Or do you go to acting class? Like, what do you do to get better at that?
Practice going off with my dad and trying to talk to myself in the mirror so far. But I can't take myself seriously, but I'm trying.
Yeah, you got to get over that. You got to start getting serious.
Yeah. So when I go out there, it all clicks and turns on.
Yeah, is that something that is, like, natural because you're second generation? Is it more natural just to you in general? Like you could just flip the switch and boom, you're a wrestler?
It was actually really hard at first, but I feel like when I go out the curtain, like all the fans there and like getting that adrenaline rush really helps me like flip the switch.
What is it like about wrestling that you love like the most? Like what's like your, I know we're talking about like chain wrestling and stuff, but what do you like? Is it the fans? Is it the matches? Is it like the character stuff? Like what kind of is your favorite part of wrestling?
My favorite part, I think, is traveling, like getting to see all the place, like all around the world being a wrestler. That's the part that sticks out to me the most.
So many wrestlers always say, like, oh, I want to wrestle in Japan. Well, you did that. You did it first, actually, wrestle in Japan.
Yeah.
Is there any other place like you'd love to wrestle or is Japan you want to make sure you get back there? Like, where do you want to wrestle as far as travel is concerned?
Well, I want to go to all 50 states, but I want to go to other countries, too. I would love to wrestle back, go back to Japan and wrestle. I'd love to go to Spain. Barcelona is like on the top of my list that I want to places I want to visit. I'd love to wrestle in Mexico, Canada, all the places like that. I'd love to wrestle in Korea too.
As we hit the wind down, we're going to head towards the finish. As far as like WWE is concerned, is that on your radar or you maybe feel you're not ready for that yet? Or is that a long-term goal? What do you think about WWE maybe in your future?
I really hope to reach that level. I really want to be in the WWE. It's cool. I feel like that's the top. I feel like that's the top for me right now.
Is that the ultimate goal?
I say my ultimate goal is probably I want to be in a movie. I want to have an action figure. I want to be in a video game. I kind of want it all. But
nice. I love that. You get a high goals, you know? High goal, high reward. Also with you, obviously, you know, you mentioned team with your dad and stuff. Is there some other dream opponents or maybe like a dream match, other girls you haven't wrestled yet that you'd love to wrestle?
I want to wrestle Bianca Carelli.
Santino's daughter, right?
Santino's daughter, yeah. Santino's daughter.
I think she was on the pay-per-view too, yeah. She was on the pay-per-view too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't become her. Anybody,
yeah, I want to wrestle her.
Anybody like legend status or like, you know, some of the big names that you would love to get in there and wrestle? Like Mickey maybe?
Yeah, I would love that. I want to wrestle Charlotte Flair too. She's really good. I feel like she's on top of women's wrestling right now. And I would love to be at the same level as her and get to wrestle her.
They always say, or like a lot of wrestlers say, that the way that they got better is by wrestling somebody better. Like, yeah, obviously, if you get in there with Charlotte, you're going to become better. Do you believe in that? Like, if you wrestle somebody good, you can raise your game?
Yeah, but I also believe wrestling people kind of lower than you really raises your game because it makes you be more of a leader or help them, make them come up to your level. That's more of a challenge, I think.
Carrying them, right? And leading the match.
Yeah.
So for you, let's just say a few years from now, we won't talk like long term, we'll say maybe even more of a short term. Where do you see yourself? And like, what do you want to be doing? And where do you want to be just like in the short term?
Short term, I just want to master the craft and be a like well-rounded wrestler, be able to do it all.
Do you see yourself going anywhere, like, specifically as far as, like, you know, I know you got Shimmer out there and stuff and Stardom out there in Japan. Do you see yourself, like, anywhere particular as, like, a landing spot in the near future?
Not as right now, but we'll see what the future holds.
So before we let you go, and I know you mentioned having all the social media and stuff, give everybody your plugs where everybody can find you, where everybody can see you.
Okay, so Instagram's Jazzy Yang. My Twitter and Facebook are Jazzy Wang Yang. And my TikTok's JasmineY3. But you can also search Jazzy Yang for that one, too. And I have a nonprofit called Wrestling for the Kiddos. It's where I raise money to help pay for kids' sports fees. And it's Wrestling for the Kiddos on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter.
Nice. I like that. Good stuff. Now, give us something, you know, leave us off on a good note as far as, like, your character, maybe not, like a little promo, like it, like what we're going to see from you coming up.
Okay. It's your girl, Jazz Yang, the last dragon princess. I'm the baddest mofo no down around here.
Nice. I like it. Good stuff. But Jazzy, thank you so much. I appreciate all the time. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Do you want to talk to my dad?
Sure.
Okay.
This has been a John Paz Power Trip production in conjunction with the Two Man Power Trip of Wrestling. You can follow us on Instagram and Twitter at Two Man Power Trip. You can check us out on Facebook. You can subscribe on YouTube. You can go to patreon.com/TMPTEmpire to become a patron. And also check out the website, TMPTEmpire.com. And buy a shirt at ProWrestlingTees.com. Two Man Power Trip, where the power lies, brother.